So I have it pinned in the first lines people see when they join us. But boy, you have beautiful weather too. Can you tell us who you are and tell us about the chateau and what you do and how things are there, basically?
So I'm Caroline. I am a winemaker in Serrance, so in the Grave appellation. And the same time in Serrance, that Serrance is the smallest appellation of Bordeaux, next to Barsac and Sauternes. So we are south of Bordeaux on the left bank. I am in charge of the commercialization and winemaking in Château de Serrance. And voilà, that's my life. I have 4 children. For the moment, all the family is in the vineyard. They are all working for different companies. So we are all regrouped in one place and during this confinement. So that's the positive point of this incredible story.
They're in the vineyard there with you, or they're all in different vineyards?
No. They are not in vineyards. Was in a, one is a nurse in Paris. Other one is an architect, and she's working here. And for the moment, but usually she's in Marseille.
Okay.
Other one is working for another vineyard of Bordeaux, as she's in charge of the press. And the last one is working for a wine merchant and he lives in Shanghai usually. But now okay. They are here.
Okay.
That's incredible.
That's great. It's such a weird time. Yep. And that's part of the reason I wanted to do this is because I was lucky enough to get out of New York into Connecticut. But many people are confined to the house, especially in New York or in apartments. And there's a lot of virtual wine tastings and happy hours. And I thought, let's go to the source and show some winemakers and some vineyards and be a little educational, but a little break from the indoors. Can you tell us about Serrance? Because I don't think people know it very much. Becky Sue Epstein is an expert on sweet wine. And she had asked, is Serrance part of Sauternes? And can you explain how that works?
Serrance is a single appellation. It's just behind Sauternes and Barsac. So it doesn't belong to Sauternes. Serrance is really a single appellation because of the subsoil, which is very special. But we are not closed, and we do the wine on the same way with botrytis. And you know, I heard you spoke with Berenice from Chateau Climat yesterday.
Yeah.
So I will not repeat, but we are really in an extraordinary microclimate here. Serrance, the name of the appellation, comes from the name of the small river, the Siron River. So that was the birthplace of this extraordinary microclimate. Today, Serrance is really unknown. I like to say it's a pearl because it's so small in terms of surface, in terms of production, it was really the birthplace, but city as Sauternes and Barsac. The wines have another balance. They are more mineral, and you will understand why, because our subsoil is very specific, and it's less sweet, and so it has a strong personality. It's nice to see that when you travel between Sauternes, Barsac, and Serrance, the wines have different profile and different balance too.
It's actually really interesting to try those side by side because people don't often have the opportunity, but it's very true. And don't be afraid of repeating because some people didn't see yesterday and they jump on here for a few. And so it's not a worry to repeat. You make dry red, dry white and red also, right?
Yes, it's a unique estate because we are able to produce Serrance sweet wines, of course, but we belong to the Grave appellation also. So we produce Château de Serrance in red and dry white. And that comes from the terroir. It's a great terroir for the three colors. For the red, because we have extraordinary subsoil for Cabernet Sauvignon and Merlot. For the white, because the Sémillon is the king in this area. The Sémillon produce extraordinary sweet wines, but also dry whites. And so we have Sémillon and Sauvignon Blanc. And for the sweet wines, we have this microclimate coming from the Ciron River. So we produce Cérons, sweet wines with Sémillon and Muscadel. And I forgot to tell you, we have, and it is very important because I love it, we have some Sauvignon white in the dry whites.
Excellent. Okay. And Becky Sue Epstein asked again, what is this subsoil there? If you could repeat that for us.
Alors, Cérons on this the appellation is limited by the plaque of seashells subsoil. It's a very very strong subsoil made with seashells and limestone, and so that's the subsoil. But the soil is made with gravel and sand. Okay. So we have this extraordinary wedding blend between a grave subsoil, and a limestone with seashells, very strong limestone subsoil. So that means the roots, when you plant new vines, the roots are very fast. They are blocked by these plaques of limestone. They run along to find some water, and when they find a break, they go deeper. So the vines here, they have very, very long roots, and so that gives a great typicity to the wines. I know it's not easy to speak about minerality, but you really find here on this appellation the precision, the transparency, the purity of the wines, and that comes really from this typical subsoil.
What is the age of your vines there?
Oh, it's a middle of... do you want to see something?
Yes,
I would love it.
I would love it. And if you click on the upper left, I think you know this. You can turn the camera around so you can aim it better if you want to show the vineyard.
Okay. If you are sick, you tell me stop.
No,
okay?
I think it's fine. Thank you.
So here, we are just in front of the château. I don't know if you
beautiful.
See that.
Yes, it's gorgeous.
We can speak after about architecture. But it's a 17th, 18th century Chartreuse. It's a typical house built by the wine merchant in Bordeaux at the end of the 17th century. So it's protected by the historical monuments, and we are in love with this chateau. It's a family house at the same time. So that means we are living on the right part. Perhaps we can have a look inside after if
oh,
you
cool.
want. But it's a typical Chartreuse from Bordeaux, and it's protected. It's voilà. It's a very nice place to be blocked during this confinement. We are very lucky.
Yeah. Can you explain what a Chartreuse is? Many people don't know the word. And also, how is the chateau named Château de Cérons? Was it the first chateau or the chateau of the village?
I explain you what is a Chartreuse.
Okay.
So now we are in front, I think.
Beautiful.
Voilà.
Yeah.
So you see it's a long house with traversing room. It was very fashionable at the 18th century. It was exactly the same philosophy as today, when everywhere in the world people built wineries with extraordinary architects. They want to show they are successful. They love art. They love modern art. So that was exactly the philosophy at this time. It was very fashion to build these houses and to have nice people for the decoration inside. It was a house made to produce wine and in the same time to welcome people. So perhaps we can do a tour inside after.
I'd love it.
But it's a very typical architecture, and the idea turn around the light to have as much light as possible inside.
Okay.
So it's oriented west to east to have the sun during all the day. A Chartreuse is usually less than one day by horse from Bordeaux. so not far away, to be able for the owner to be able to come and to check what's happened on the vineyard and to meet the teams in place. So it was very important to be not far away. Most of the time, it's along the river, along the Garonne. So the Garonne is just behind the big trees you see here.
Yeah.
And the idea was, of course, to be able to sell the wines and to send it on the river to Bordeaux.
Oh, right. Yeah. Okay.
Voilà. So that was a question of logistics, and it was much easier to be along the river as to be obliged to transport the wines. So that was much, much easier. So, and most of the time, these chartreuses are built on nice terroir, of course.
Yeah.
Because the idea was to produce great wines and high quality of wines. So in Bordeaux, you have a lot of chartreuses, and that's really the signature of the wineries in Bordeaux at the 18th century.
I love voilà. that. I didn't know you were such a historian and architect. I love it.
It's a luck. We are lucky. So that's why we decided with Xavier to took in charge his estate in 2012. It was a family estate. We were living there with our children. We are there since 30 years. And the family of Xavier, it's a large family. There are 8 children. Xavier is the youngest. The transmission, you can imagine, was difficult. So we took the risk to purchase it. And a big risk for us, big challenge, and to continue this extraordinary tradition in the family. And so now we are managing this extraordinary estate. But the chateau was important for us because it's not only a chateau, it's a family house.
Yeah.
And around the chateau, we have 3 hectares of vines. In total, the estate is 30 hectares. But here we have, to answer to your question, we have 2 generations of vines. Here you have the Merlot we planted in 2013 as we arrived. So do you see it?
Yep.
Voilà. So that's a plot of Merlot producing very nice wines since 4 years. And you see they are young. It's yeah. a young plot. And you see the bugs, it's the nature, it's growing very fast because we have high temperature.
Uh-huh.
So that's interesting. And you see in the vineyard, we work with favol beans.
Uh-huh.
And in the middle, and to take care of the soil and the subsoil.
Can you explain that a little more? You showed me the fava beans the other day. Why you plant them, how the height helped with the frost, and what it does for the soil?
These beans, so I go in the... So you will see it from here. They are covering the soil. You can see that. And so that blocked the bad herbs to grow. We are not disturbing since 7 years here. So we only use different plants depending on the year to protect the soil, to give nutriment to the soil. So that's very traditional way of growing wines, and very natural one. And these one are interesting because the bees like it. So most of the time you have lot of bees taking the sugar of the plants here. So that's interesting. Oula. So Laurel arrive, our small dog.
Oh. Voilà. Awesome.
So that's important for us. And these favol, they are nice, especially when they are high like that. We discovered this year that they protected the young bugs from the frost. Mm. So that was really interesting. We have to prove it, but that was what we saw in the vineyard. You know, we had very cold nights on Friday last week.
Uh-huh.
And we were very anxious to have frost, but of course it's okay. And at all the plots with this favol, we had absolutely no frost. So excellent. We have to check if it's a generality or if, voilà. So that's a young plot of Merlot. And on the other side, up, we go here. You have a plot planted by the grandfather of Xavier, my husband, and that's Sémillon.
Voilà. Okay.
So you see, the bugs are smaller. It's not so so big, and they just start.
Yeah.
Voilà. So it's another plot, and you have between these two plots, two generation of winemakers.
It's really beautiful there. That's one of the other reasons I started this, because a friend of mine said, Jeff, the vines don't stop. I was asking about the quarantine, and he had ordered some Chenin vines that he had to plant, and you guys have to get out there and do the work, even though we're under quarantine.
Yes. You know,
can you finish what you're saying, but can you also tell us at this time of year what you would normally be doing and how the quarantine has affected that? But finish your first thought.
No. It was the same. It was the same idea. You know, it started on 2 weeks ago, the confinement in France, and I was just coming back from New York. We had a nice event with a strong woman in wine, organized with 25 different women producing wine everywhere in Bordeaux from each appellation. It was a success. We were like in a dream in New York.
I saw the restaurant. I'd love to hear more about that because it looked very, very cool.
Well, so I just came from this event, and as I arrived here, it was the war. And I say, what's happened here? Yes, we have to stop to work to protect the people working on the estate, and so we decided to invite all the people working in the office to stay home. Mm-hmm. But of course, the rest of the team had to be outside because you see, it's growing every minute, every night. We have a lot of work to do now, and so the team is working outside. It's a luck for us because the nature is the strongest. So we have to follow it. We have to change the ID. We have to be concentrated on the 2020 vintage. And that's a luck for us because we are, I think today with the sales and the relation we have with our importers, everywhere in the world, it's blocked. So it's blocked for everybody. We have to stay in touch, to be patient, and to focus on the next vintage. So that's why we are lucky, because we can change our mind and to say, okay, now with the business, we have to respect this big crazy. It will come back. We have to take care of our family, of our team, and we have to take care of the vineyard. So we are outside, and in the vineyard, they all work on different plots. So they are not together. And you know, here we are not meeting a lot of people. We, in the winter, they are only with their own family.
Right.
So the risk is lower. We have less risk.
Yeah. It's very optimistic and hopeful to see that, you know, the vineyard continues and you have a crop and it's like, keep going. For me, it's a relief to kind of see there's an optimism to it.
Yes, it's great. But I have to tell you, when we stand up in the morning, we pray to say, okay, I hope it will not dure too long.
Yeah.
And everybody will be able to. But the positive point is the people, they rediscover their own cellars. and we receive a lot of pictures and with people opening bottles and doing recipes. And they give us their point of view. It's not positive, this COVID, but you have positive points.
You have positive points, and it's good to focus on that. Yeah. Do y'all have questions for Caroline? She's clearly super knowledgeable and charming in her education. Was New York successful? Did you have fun?
We had fun. That was we were so warm, welcome by the restaurant in New York and by the sommelier. So that was really, really positive. I think most of the people were happy to rediscover Bordeaux with another mind, another image, because we were women. I think it was important to show Bordeaux is not is different. Bordeaux has men and women and young and older people, and you have a younger generation who really arrive in the vineyard. I was the older. I was not perhaps not the older, but we had a mix of young and older women. It was interesting to share our point of view and to give our energy, and we received a lot from the American markets because a lot of them rediscovered Bordeaux, and that was the positive point. I think Bordeaux is more relaxed than people imagine, and we were happy to be there and to speak about the different colors of Bordeaux, the red, the dry white, the sustainable, all the work Bordeaux is doing in the vineyard to protect the soil and the next generations, and to speak about all the research we are doing in our vineyard every day, and the result we have in the vineyards or during the vinification. So I think it was positive for everybody. I hope they will do it again next year. We have a lot of things to tell.
I think that's exciting. I hope you do it next year. My friend Anne Lataste, who I mentioned to you before, is from Serrance, and she was asking, I think you weren't clear about the history of the name of Chateau de Serrance. And then In the Grape was asking about your winemaking for the sweet wine.
Okay. So it's very, very rare to have the name of your own appellation. I think in Bordeaux, we are only two. You have Château Margaux in Margaux and Château de Serrance in Serrance. So the main reason is it was the main estate in the village. I don't know if you can see that, but we are in the middle of the village. Yeah. So that's unique. We are surrounded by small houses everywhere. And that was you see the architecture.
Yeah.
It was the main chateau. It was an extraordinary architecture. So that was the chateau of the village. And because the appellation is the name of the village, voilà, that's the reason why.
Okay. And then for the winemaking, just briefly, I have to get off in about 3 minutes because I'm joining Véronique Dos at Chateau Félon-Ségur. So briefly, okay. Can you tell us about the winemaking for the sweet wine?
So it's the same winemaking as Sauternes and Barsac. We are expecting botrytis. So this botrytis is a small fungus would arrive in this area around the Siron River. The Siron River has very cold water because it's in the forest coming from the middle of the region. In the shadow, even in the summer, the water are very cold. And as they meet the water of the Garonne River, and when the nights are cold, so the three phenomena, fresh water from the Siron, warm water from the Garonne, and fresh nights, so it means in September, October, we have fog in the morning, so you can't see anything, you can't see the chateau in the morning. You have fog, this fog helps a fungus to develop on the over-ripened grapes of Sémillon we let outside, and this fungus makes step-by-step concentration. And when you see the berries, they are completely attacked by this fungus, and they are concentrated. And we are picking day after day only the berries with a lot of botrytis and very concentrated. And we do very small harvest, and we press in the night very slowly to have this sweet wine. So the juice go directly in oak barrel, and the fermentation take place in the oak barrel. Voilà. And step by step, we are controlling the fermentation. It can take a long time. It can finish in Christmas sometimes. In 1990, it was fermenting for Christmas. And we are clearing the wine step by step. The fermentation stop by itself because it's so sweet. The yeast are a little bit upside down. And after, we produce this extraordinary wine. But here in Château de Serrance, we keep the wine 10 years before to sell it.
Wow.
So we are not now selling the 2011 vintage. It's a little bit our pearl, our jewel.
So do you ferment the first tree separately from the second tree and then the third and then blend after?
Yes, on each barrel you have the date of the picking, and we blend it quite late. They all stay separate like different notes of music, and we prefer to blend it as, you know, with sweet wines we have time.
Yeah.
You don't need to be worried.
Yeah, that's awesome.
So we take our time. Sweet wines is complicated because sometimes you have no botrytis, so you lose everything, some vintages. So the difficult point is to pick at the best time and to have the chance to have some concentration by botrytis. The fermentation is very easy.
That is so fascinating. Carolyn, I have to jump off, but it has been such a pleasure to talk to you. Everybody stay tuned. We're going to be with Phelan Segura in 1 minute, and Veronique will talk with us. But Carolyn, this was fantastic. Everybody, I'm going to try to post where you can buy Chateau Serrance and look for it for among the sweet wine aficionados. It's a really special wine. Thank you, Carolyn.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Jeff. It was a smile to see you.
Excellent.
Bye.
Take care now. Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye.